Good morning, everyone. From Studio B in Charlotte, North Carolina, I'm John Roberts, and we are ready to go racing in Atlanta. Coming up in just a couple of minutes, get all the nuts and bolts on NASCAR Tech. Then join us for exclusive live pre-race coverage on NASCAR This Morning on Fox Sports Net. Then NASCAR Winston Cup Racing, presented by UPS, is on your local Fox affiliate at 12:30. And join us back here for NASCAR Victory Lane on Fox Sports Net at 9 o'clock local time. It's a full day of racing, and it's all here on Fox.
Hello, Stephanie.
Hi, Ned, and hello to all of you. Welcome to NASCAR Tech.
Isn't it nice to finally be on a set?
Absolutely. We've been out in the field now for about 4 weeks, and it's great to be back with you, and I was getting kind of lonely out there.
Well, so was I. And while we were out in the field, the Jasper Race team was kind enough to let us use their shop as our home base, and we wish to extend to them our gratitude for their generosity.
We certainly do. You know, we have a lot of great things in store for the fans this season on NASCAR Tech.
Yes, we do. And one of the most exciting features we have planned is building a race car. Stephanie, did you know that it takes more than 1,000 man hours to build a race car?
That's amazing.
Now, that was a long time ago when I drove race cars that it took that long, and I suspect today that it takes even longer because of all the attention that's paid to the aerodynamic package on the race cars. So we'll begin our construction on a race car as we kick off a weekly series in NASCAR Know-How. And we're going to break it down for our viewers over a 9-week period.
That's right. We'll get an insider's look at the construction of a race car with hopes of seeing our own NASCAR Tech logo hit the track later this season. This promises to be a lot of fun for us and for the fans.
Well, it certainly will be. And the perfect place to start, of course, is with the chassis. As we begin construction, we'll engage the help of Moog, manufacturer of many of the chassis parts found on a race car.
NASCAR Inspector Brian DeHart will take us through the inspection process, showing us what inspectors check for in chassis design and construction. The main feature of chassis construction and an aspect that is critical to the safety of a race car is, of course, the roll cage.
It certainly is, and this is an important feature, particularly when it comes to safety. And it has changed a great deal over the years in NASCAR racing. I know in my career, I've certainly seen a real transformation in the roll cage. Back when I drove race cars, the roll cage consisted basically of four bars that went from the roof down by the windshield and two behind the driver, and they were all tied together and welded into the frame, and that was basically it. But we'll take a look at the evolution that has taken place over the last 50 years.
There is a lot happening, so let's get to it when we return with NASCAR Tech right here on Fox Sports Net.
NASCAR Tech on Fox Sports Net is brought to you by Goodyear. Serious technology, freedom from worry.
If the cockpit of the race car is home to NASCAR's top stars, then the roll cage is the framework that holds it all together. Underneath the sheet metal and vivid paint schemes is an extensive network of tubing that's welded together to form a cocoon, which is designed to insulate the driver from harm.
You get right down to it, the cage is what holds everything, you know, all the other safety features. I mean, the seat's hooked to it, the seat belts are hooked to it, your steering columns, your brake pedals, I mean, just about everything that's built around this race car is based off the frame and roll cage.
But it's taken years of development to get to that point. In the early days of NASCAR, there was no such thing as a roll cage. Some cars were driven straight from the road onto the racetrack, and additional supports were often non-existent.
You just wonder how you got by back in those days to the point where you are today.
When I go back and look and reflect on some of the older cars, the cars that ran in the 50s and the 60s, I'm frightened.
If we put a roll bar in it, it could have been out of exhaust pipe tubing, just so long as it looked pretty good. And we felt like, well, you know, that's going to be too bad.
Even as NASCAR moved into its modern era, the roll cage still had a long way to go.
Kim, what were these roll cages like when you first got into this sport?
You could use black pipe, you could use old stick welders. They weren't very good.
But as the sport progressed, so did NASCAR's knowledge of safety. A bar here and a bar there were added until eventually the driver was encased in a protective capsule.
Over the years, they see where a problem is and then they put an extra bar in there to help strengthen the whole system.
From race to race, anytime there's a big wreck, all the crew chiefs, we look at the cars and see what we can do better, and it's very important that we keep these drivers safe, and it keeps the sport safe.
And that's why NASCAR has spent the past half century developing strict guidelines for the roll cage as we know it today.
The part of the cage that surrounds a race car driver has evolved over the last 30, 40 years into something that is extremely safe and strong.
Our speeds kept getting higher and higher, and of course we've had some spectacular crashes, and just to be able to see some of these drivers walk away from these incredible wrecks is something that I think that the fabricators and the people who designed the cages should be proud of, and they've done a great job.
The most important aspect to the construction of anything is a solid foundation. Stability and durability are key components of this concept. Today, we're visiting with the director of Motorsports for Moving Chassis Parts, Bob Staub. Bob, welcome to NASCAR Tech.
Thanks, Ned. It's great to be here.
Now, you folks make a variety of chassis parts for both race cars and street use. Now, I'm sure the fans out there don't know where these parts are and what they do. Let's show them.
Okay, great. Moog manufactures an upper ball joint, a lower ball joint, an outer tie rod end, and an inner tie rod end that are used on the race cars. The upper ball joint is very important because it controls the inward and outward tilt of the top of the tire, which is the camber setting.
Now that would keep the tire flat on the ground.
That's what we want to do. The lower ball joint, which is actually the weight carrier, it actually carries the weight of the race car. The coil spring sits on the lower control arm. The ball joint's mounted in the end of the control arm, which is hooked to the spindle, which comes up to the hub. And then the tire's mounted out here and it sits on the racetrack. And it actually carries the weight. So these two pieces are very, very important on this race car. The inner and the outer tie rod ends are also very important. They're hooked to the center link, which is hooked to a steering arm, which goes up to the steering wheel in the driver's hand. And when the driver turns that steering wheel, he wants the wheels to turn. So the tie rod ends have to be tight, and they have to stay tight during the whole race and everything. Because if they change just a little bit, the toe changes on the car, it begins to scrub the tire, and when you get tire scrub, you change the speed and the car begins to slow down. And we don't want this to happen.
Okay, let's move up to the desk now and take a look at how those parts are made and why they're made that way.
Okay, fine.
Bob, these parts look a little bit different here on the desk than they did on the race car.
Yes, they sure do, Ned. I'd like to show you how these parts are put together. I'd like to start with the lower ball joint that's we use in these race cars. Here's the powdered metal bearing on the front side, the stud. Here you can see the powdered metal bearing that's on the back side. Here you can see the bevel washer, which puts the preload in it, the crush plate, the back plate, and how it's all spun back together.
It has to be a ball so that it can move in any direction because of varying conditions that your wheels might hit.
Absolutely. Now the stud in the ball joint moves not only this way and this way, but when they turn the wheels, the stud also has to turn as the wheels turn. So it's the ball joint is probably, as I said before, the most important part of that race car because it holds the wheels on the car. And without this, the race car is going nowhere.
Yeah.
Now the tie rod ends that we use on the race car, and this is one of them right here. And this is the axle tie rod end that's used on the car. Here again, we use the bearing on the front side of the stud. It is a full ball stud. It drops down into place. And then we made a powdered metal bearing that goes on the back side of the stud, and it drops right down into place. Here again, we use the bevel washer. The tapered washer is the preload. Then we put the crush plate in, and then the back plate goes on, and it's all spun together and locked up the way it's supposed to be.
We've seen how important chassis construction is for cars on the track. When NASCAR Tech returns, we'll take a look at the differences between NASCAR frame construction and the unibody construction found on many consumer cars. So stay with us. Our guest is Bob Staub, Director of Motorsports for Moog Chassis Parts. Bob, I was surprised to hear you say that the parts that you make for race cars also are the same parts for street use.
That's right, Ned. We, everything that we have on a race car is a cataloged application. We don't make anything special for racing, and this is why they work so great. You know, I mentioned to you before that greasing these parts is extremely important. The M2 technology that we've used on this stuff with the old gusher bearing that we designed many, many years ago, this is one of the bearings that's used inside this thing, or a piece of the material, and it's actually totally soaked in oil. And when we take this little airbag and we squeeze on it, we actually blow the oil right out of the bearing. Wow. As you can see, it just bubbles out of there. Well, that's what happens inside this thing as it's in a car, a pickup truck, a race car, whatever it might be. Now, some of the other applications that we did was because we talk about lubrication. This is a Honda Civic ball joint. And the problem that they had with this Honda Civic ball joint was they can't put a grease fitting in it because of the way it's installed in the car. It fits so close that there's no way to lubricate it. The other part of it is that we want to keep all the contaminants out. So we made this polyurethane boot to go on here, and we actually seal it onto the ball joint. And when it goes into the car, it's actually sealed around the stud so no contaminants can get inside. And the ball joint is continually lubricating itself. The big thing about all of these pieces is when the customer needs their, the fans need to really take a look at their cars occasionally and check the tire wear. When they see the tires wearing uneven, they need to take the car to an alignment shop and have the alignment checked. It's like the race cars, the alignment's checked on them before they go on the racetrack, and you must have tight parts in there. And that's why we recommend that they ask for Moog chassis parts, the problem solvers in the industry.
Good advice, and your fans should take that advice. Bob, thank you so much for joining us here on NASCAR Tech.
Ned, it's been great.
Thank you. We've seen how important chassis parts are, both on and off the track. Next up, Stephanie and NASCAR official Brian DeHart take a look at how NASCAR regulates the design and construction of the chassis for the race teams.
We're talking with NASCAR Inspector Brian DeHart. Brian, obviously we have a bare roll cage here. This is not what the NASCAR technical inspectors would see when the cars go through the inspection line at the racetrack. But for illustration purposes, can you show us kind of what you guys are looking for when the cars do come through inspection?
Well, Stephanie, we look at our roll cage. We're very proud of our roll cage. It's an evolution over like the past 50 years of racing that each bar has a reason why it's been put there in the past and stuff. So we're very proud of it. We have one inspector on Friday mornings when we open up that is extensively in charge of the roll cage, and he spends a lot of time checking the integrity of it. We have a lot of different gauges and stuff. Some of them as simple as a tape measure for measuring door bar lengths and door bar heights. But one specific area we can concentrate on is the thickness of it. We have a sonic tester that checks the thickness of each bar to ensure that it meets the minimum standards set forth by the rule book.
Now, how were the rules determined as far as door bar lengths, door bar heights? Why are those specifications put in place?
Just in the past 4, 5, or 6 years, it's really flourished, and there's been a lot of teams that have started building their own cages, and it's been harder to keep up with because so many people are doing. We've probably got 10 or 15 different builders now that are building chassis on. So what we had to do to prevent the chassis from getting smaller or getting lighter, which today's world, light is better for the race teams, we ended up having to come up with some measurements and some guidelines that each builder must follow to ensure that each chassis is a minimum standard.
Now, how do you guys ensure that when these teams get to the track? Because obviously this thing is built and put together when the cars get to the track.
Right, well, some of it's as simple as like a tape measure. I mean, like we have some minimum standards that we have on the door bars. The door bars are a very important part that protects the driver and stuff. We have a minimum height that each door, the top door bar must be off the frame rail, which is 21 1/4 inches. We also have a minimum length of the door bars, which measured center to center must be 42 3/4 inches long.
What about this area right here? I know a lot of people refer to this as the halo bar.
Yeah, we call this bar number three. Like I said, each bar has a number, and that's bar number three in our minds, but the terminology in the garage is the halo bar. And as you can see, it's the integrity of the upper portion of the roll cage. And we want to keep this bar wide and long in the front to help keep it away from the driver and help well protect the driver and anything that around the car.
And I guess it is extremely vital that the teams meet the specifications because it all boils down to safety.
Sure, I mean, that's the number one name of the game for us is safety. And like I said, the roll cage is the integrity and the backbone of our race car. So that's why we pay particular attention to it, because we want to ensure that that driver is as safe as possible.
Straight ahead on NASCAR Tech, we'll show you how the complete chassis comes together as we begin building our own NASCAR Tech race car. Don't go away.
Yellow breather room, run your line. Clear.
What we're doing today is starting the construction of a NASCAR Winston Cup race car. Starting with the frame rails. One frame rail is already laid. This piece here is a truck arm cross member. NASCAR mandates the thickness and the width of this tubing, which is 120 wall, 2x2 tubing. Next step will be the right side frame rail. What we've done is we've laid down the main rails. This makes up the structure of the race car. This is where every race car starts. We've laid in a truck arm cross member. This is what the rear suspension points will hook to, the truck arms. The brackets that we're assembling on now is where the truck arms will actually bolt and go back to hook to the rear end. The next piece to the puzzle of building this car is a rear clip. This is the rear section of the car that actually holds the fuel cell. The shock mount's hooked to it, and it supports the body, the whole back of the car. What we have here is the rear clip fixture jig. The rear clip all starts out with three individual pieces of 2x3 083 tubing that are welded together on a flat table. The rear section's added. The two pieces of tubing that make up the fuel cell area and a shock tower, which is built in a jig and then set up here and welded in position. The braces are welded after that. Once that's all welded together, we put in the fuel cell straps that hold the fuel cell in position. Once the rear clip is all welded together, then we take the rear clip from the fixture jig and put it into the main jig where it gets welded to the roll cage. It'll just get laid into the main jig and clamped in place. The next step is to tie the rear clip into the main frame rails. The first thing that we did was put in the spring bucket, which controls the height of the car. The next thing we do is the front frame horn. This tube is a sway bar tube. This will hook to the front clip with bushings, and your sway bar arms will come to the back of the low control arms, which controls the roll of the race car. We've completely assembled the left side. I'm putting the right side up in position. Once everything is in position and clamped, the next step is you'll weld this all together to make one piece. Next step will be put on the upper A-frame plate. This holds the suspension bolt to the upper A-frame plate. The next step will be to add the floor pan. NASCAR uses the same floor pan in all Winston Cup and Busch race cars. The roll cage tubing comes in random length. We put it in the tubing bender, bend it the shape we want, where we take it to the roll cage jig. It gets totally welded and put onto the main chassis. It gets set on the frame rails, gets measured out, squared up side to side, and welded down. The next step will be to add the rear kickers. They protect the fuel cell area in the case of a wreck. The next step is to add a fuel cell hoop. We have three stabs that hold this in position onto the rear frame. This completes the center section and the rear clip. Our next step is to move to the front clip, add the front legs. The front legs brace up the front clip, tie it into the main roll cage and the rear clip. We'll add an X bar. We use the front axle. Once this section is welded, the final piece to this race car is inside the cockpit. One bar runs from the top of the cage on the right side down to the top of the truck arm cross member. Once that's all welded in place, that is the cockpit of the race car.
A pit crew can adjust the race car's wheel alignment in a matter of minutes. It's part of what we do between practice runs to tweak the steering and suspension to get the best handling possible. When Kenny Wallace has to maneuver his way around and through traffic on the track, his car's agility depends on accurate steering and alignment. Aside from handling, wheel alignment also affects tire wear on the racetrack and on the highway. A set of tires can be ruined in a hurry because of misaligned wheels. If you've ever driven a car that veers off to one side of the road, you know that you're constantly having to steer it back on the track, and that causes rapid tire wear. Believe me, NASCAR drivers don't want to make an extra pit stop for tires any more than you do. The Car Care Council reminds you that rotating, balancing, and aligning wheels can make for a better ride, improved handling, and longer tire life.
Today on Fox, it's Winston Cup Racing live from Atlanta, presented by UPS. It all takes place at one of the fastest tracks on the Winston Cup circuit, the Atlanta Motor Speedway. Coverage begins today at 12:30 p.m. Eastern, 9:30 a.m. Pacific on your local Fox affiliate.
Well, that's all the time we have for today. We'll see you next time.
Stay tuned for NASCAR This Morning right here on Fox Sports Net.
Thanks for watching.